Right. I'm used to I'm used to hearing messages in the music from other genres, even instrumental music. I'm used to hearing the messages that come out of it. So, I'm gonna in the time that I have to be able to record and create songs and drop verses and sing hooks or whatever the case may be, or even if I'm entirely singing the song, I'm gonna try to say some stuff. The one downfall from growing up the way I did, listening to the music that I did, was that there was so many love songs that I'm not gonna say that I'm tired of love songs, but love songs don't fit as much in reference to the creation of music these days anymore with the younger generation anyway. And I think a
Well,
small part of that, the oversaturation of love songs from back in the day,
nah, they're making a whole bunch of emo love songs in certain factors. It's just they're not the kind of spectrum. So it happens they make all these
maybe
weird love
likely
songs, and
back in
then y'all are like, you know what, that's not my cup of tea. But they're like my heart's broke, shorty broke my heart, and they're saying it in ways that are more their language. They drop, but yo, I've heard like there's no way like Lil Uzi Vert drops entire projects dedicated to heartbreak. Right, it's just then you have to listen to Lil Uzi Vert, which I do, if I could like this guy's
I
music.
mean, I guess if I don't be an old fogey and step back and think about it, then at least in attempt, there isn't much difference between a Lil Uzi Vert releasing something like that and Marvin Gaye's double album, Hear My Dear, which basically talked about his entire divorce from his wife. So, I guess there really
Exactly.
isn't much of a difference, right?
I mean, except that he's young and it's different. And literally, it's a young heartbreak. So it would have been like Marvin Gaye's
Right, I
20-year-old
got
heartbreak. And I think in a lot of ways, if you look at a lot of the classic dudes too, just back then, if you look at music history, most of them like weren't necessarily 20 dropping original music like that. They were usually 20 doing covers, migrating a one, two original in as their careers would progress. And it was usually a bit later on in life that they would actually get into these originals. Not across the board, but like most people weren't like 19-year-old pop stars, whereas a lot of these kids are. So the songs are going to be about completely different things, just at an ethereal level.
I mean, yeah, you read about it. I mean, for the most part, hip hop is probably just about the only genre that exists without that level per se of artists. Because yeah, people could say even with Bow Wow or Romeo or even if you want to go super uber pop and do the Vanilla Ice MC Hammer type of stuff from back in the day. Yeah, it had its pop elements, but like what you just described, where you had the young up and coming artist in the genre trying to make a name for himself as an artist by doing covers of other people's things, that's really, really something that really didn't come with hip hop versus, other genres. I'm not exactly sure why. I might have an idea of why, but it's just
I
something
got
that.
lots of ideas, so I. It's a little. No, it.
Do you think it has anything to do with ghostwriting? I'm about to flip the script and start asking you the questions. Do you think
Nah, cool.
it has
This is
anything
a great chat.
to do with the concept of ghostwriting? Because I have a different approach to ghostwriting, I believe.
So, I think it has to do with. Okay, so keep in mind, everything I'm about to say is an amalgamation of me doing this with people who come from LA and New York too, and Montreal, and mostly those three cities. So from what I understand, it really starts with b-boys and graph, and there's a competitive nature to these two elements, especially the b-boys that come up. And so this battling side of things, and graph has its battling side of things. So this battling part of the elements has always been into it, however level of nice or not it was. And then as the DJs and crews come in, there's this competitive battling element to so which crew's the best, who's rocking the best party, etc. So then, if you look at the rappers and you start listening to the stories of how people in the 90s are coming up, they're going neighborhood to neighborhood to neighborhood. Oh, you got bars? Oh, you got bars? Let's go. Who's got the best bars? But to win this battle, you have to have your own voice, your own sword, your own technique. You gotta be coming with your own shit. So I think it's more that a lot of the roots of the cultures in some of these key locations are so specifically rooted in an ability to prove that you have the skills to bring it that are authentic and unique. And part of that was going around and just being able to freestyle and be able to bring your bars and do all of this shit. And that was in Montreal. That was in so many other cities. The exact same story about people going hood to hood and battling and doing this whole thing. And honestly, I think I'm part of the first generation of like internet rappers, really, who never had to do any of that shit. I was just able to upload my first song to SoundCloud and Reverb Nation and run with it. Never had to do it. So up until like 2010, you have this whole path and this way of going about it because there's no legitimacy. And then hip hop goes pop. The whole world changes.
Well, I mean, I feel what you're saying. And I would counter with my thoughts on this. I understand the fact, and I guess the originality in reference to the alleged originality, and I think that's an important thing, in reference to the bars, valid neighborhood, is something that's stuck on more so than the actual reality. Because once again, I'm an old head, so the examples that I just didn't think of are going to be, you know, 30 plus years ago type of shit from my childhood. I'm like, how would Run DMC and Aerosmith Walk This Way been something that would have hit today based upon that or would have been something that would have hit in the 90s or the 2000s based upon that mindset? Because really, Run DMC is doing a cover of Aerosmith's Run This Way. They ain't singing it, they're rapping it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Would the Sugar Hill Gang Rapper's Delight being the first major rap song to chart in the charts here in the United States and get on radio, what may have you, would that shit would have flown today, considering that at least a third of the lyrics wrapped in that 17 minute song was written not by the people rapping it?
Well, it depends on who you're asking and about which group of people. So if you're talking about the pop sphere, so what I'm going to call Billboard, then it don't mm-hmm. matter. Doesn't matter that Nas wrote Getting Jiggy With It. Who cares? Doesn't matter.
One of the most underrated lyrics I ever heard in hip hop music ever comes from P. Diddy. He says it all about the Benjamins. Don't worry if I write rhymes, I write checks. And I think that's one of the lyrics ever in hip hop. Because when you step back in reality, every other genre of music has its availability for its youthful up-and-coming bands or artists to do covers. It gives its ability for its young up-and-coming bands and even established ones to have other people actually write stuff for them for quality presentations of music and long-lasting sounding presentations of music. All these other genres have those angles, and this one never really had. And I never fully was able to wrap my head around why, because I don't have a problem with ghostwriting. I'll be straight up with you. I'm old school, genre minded. So if
I have a theory,
look, I don't have a problem with it, because quality music in the end, I grew up listening to quality music that obviously was not done and created just by one person. You know what I'm saying? All that great Motown stuff, all that Stax Records stuff, all the stuff that came from even the Beatles and Apple and the early MTV stuff and the New Wave stuff, because I love 80s New Wave stuff, wasn't all done exclusively by just like the band themselves. I mean, Michael Jackson didn't write all that stuff from Thriller by himself. You know what I'm saying? Prince wrote a whole lot more of Purple Rain by himself than what Michael Jackson did for Thriller, but Prince didn't write all that stuff by himself either. You know what I'm saying?
So
Janet Jackson
came
first
from her direction. I have ideas on this,
though. By hip-hop, it doesn't allow that, you know?
There's so much that you said in there that's so fucking nifty. I think that the fact of the matter is my girlfriend was able to write a rap verse pretty fucking fast, and it wasn't shit. Was it great? No. To be a good rapper isn't that hard. To be an amazing rapper is really fucking hard. And to differentiate between the two is not simple. But the actual barrier to threshold, my guy, I could make a masterclass that could teach people how to fucking write rap. It's not that hard to take it if you've done it long enough. Explain the structure of flow and get real explanatory, create exercises. You can do this shit. That means that you literally got to be really good or nobody's going to take you serious, because there's so much more to it. That's where your story, your authenticity, it's almost like your branding has to be so much more. I feel like people have always undersold the power of this, but like we all believed in the superheroes that our rappers presented more than we, you know, like the package of it, like all of it, like you liked them for so many reasons that went just beyond the rap. It was the fashion choices, it was the presentation in the video, it was the marketing, the album cover, the interviews, the consistency, the lore that got created behind these people. So if you got like this ill sense of style, it's like you're able to bring that overall lore into your bars and do something with it that other people aren't doing, because it's not actually that hard. And I say this having watched hundreds of contest entries unrelated to my own contest, but I do a contest, so I've seen hundreds and hundreds of contest entries, and I don't know, there's something about it that just happened one day at like fucking entry 400 where I'm like, there's no soul in a lot of this. So how do you get that extra element that makes you that nice with it? You know, like
let me back up a reference for the sake of conversation and lay some disclaimers. There from time to times are a series of things that I use in conversations that I call mooseisms. And they're usually either phrases or cliches or things that I use automatically to tie in towards a given part of a conversation. In this particular case, one of the mooseisms I would use is that a combination like this, as like most combinations on conversations on a day-to-day basis, could all boil down, if you dig deep enough, to one of two specific things, either overpopulation or technology. In this particular case, the reason why you're having the frustrations that you're having toward the subject matter is from the foundational pillar of technology. This is not to say that back in the day for Marvin Gaye and Stevie Wonder and Cameo and Prince and all that stuff, that they didn't have hundreds of bands around the country trying to put out R&B records, rock records, or what may have that might have had some levels of either local success. It might have been inferior shit to the stuff that we know from back in the day. But with the way technology is today, all those inferior acts that existed, you know, in our parents' generation and generations before that, now they have as much everyday access as the proverbial Motown machine to release stuff out to the masses. And the masses never knew the difference between the two anyway. So how would they have known the difference when all of it's being presented at the same time versus the cream of the crop rising through a machine? So it's really technology and stuff. The inferior stuff has always been around. But
I still think if you go back to technology, in a lot of ways, as a rapper, not the whole product, not the whole song-making machine, it's kind of like playing soccer. Anybody can just pick it up and do it. So we go back to access, which is kind of what you're saying. So if you think back to a culture where 50 people might be a rapper in a room, you got to really come at it in a way where, you know, you stand out, you got style, you got something. There's a cypher with 30 people bringing bars. How do you actually stand out in that cipher?
Well, I guess if we're talking about a cipher-like situation, that comes out to like just an individual being type of thing.
But that's how like a lot of these people, we're talking almost 20 years of this shit, grew. That's who all the rappers were. Is a lot of these guys were coming from that world, right?
So I mean, it's a matter of what that proverbial world is. And I say that coming from the perspective of another mooseism I use, and I just included this in a poem I wrote the other day for a performance, that I grew up as a middle-class huckster. And that basically means that I didn't grow up in the stereotypical richness of what the Huxtable family had on the Cosby Show. I was probably more of a middle-class level economic version of the Huxtables from the Cosby Show. Never near as rich as them, but we wasn't on Good Times, J.J. Evans level. You feel what I'm saying?